Hello everyone. In this video, we're going to be building on the definition of the weird tale that was provided to us by H.P. Lovecraft by examining the works of a more contemporary source, S.G. Joshi, one of Lovecraft's greatest biographers and literary critics, who has worked extensively over the last several decades in unpacking Lovecraft's letters, republishing them, and identifying typographical errors in the transmission of manuscripts from Lovecraft, as well as better articulating some of the themes and the ideas that Lovecraft himself has been developing. One of the things that S.G. Joshi has attempted to do is to take this basic definition of the weird tale as an emotive experience, a kind of story that evokes an emotional, subjective response from the reader, that of dread of unknown forces pressing in on our universe associated with a malign suspension of natural laws, something impossible happening, provoking a sense of existential dread and a sensation that the laws that we use to understand and to neutralize the universe are being overturned. Now, Joshi comes in, he looks at this definition, and he says that we can actually further subdivide these weird tales, as Lovecraft describes them, using his definition, but we can also provide more specific criteria in order to understand and delineate these unique approaches that authors are taking. So he takes the larger genre of the weird and breaks them down into four categories that are going to be represented by the four stories that we read at the beginning of this course: The Mark of the Beast, The Orla, Through the Dragonglass, and The Call of Cthulhu. The four categories that he presents to us are, first, supernatural weird tales, non-supernatural weird tales, fantasy weird tales, and quasi-science fiction weird tales. And we're going to go over some of the criteria that he uses to describe each of these subgenres through this video. First, you have the work of the supernatural weird tale, supernatural horror. These are the stories that we most classically associate with horror, in that there's an encounter with something that is unexplainable, or that there's an encounter with something inexplicable in the narrative, something that violates our categories, violates our understanding of the universe, something impossible that is meant to provoke in the character's dread, and in turn is reflected back upon us and our experience of the story to have us feel dread. In these stories, the apparent violation of natural law is caused by something explicitly supernatural. So you can think about a story about a werewolf, a vampire, a ghost, or a demon. These are all supernatural occurrences that overturn our understanding of the world. These stories begin with realism. The author takes careful pains to establish that everything inside the story operates according to the natural laws that we perceive in our real world. So characters will act in such a way, and events will transpire at the outset of the story in such a way, as to suggest that this world inside the fiction is almost identical to ours. Characters will then respond to whatever supernatural violations they encounter, whatever ghosts or transformations or vampires or the like that they see in the story, in the same way that we would if we encountered them in the real world. We would be shocked, horrified, upset. Things just wouldn't make sense. If you saw a ghost, you would feel terrified, and you would start to question yourself, thinking that maybe you're imagining this, maybe you're hallucinating this. And yet, once you are convinced of the reality of this, your entire understanding, likely, of how this materialistic world operates would be overturned. Natural laws, we're told by the way in which the characters react and the way in which the story is set up at the outset, are the same in this fictional world as they are in ours. This story, or this kind of story, often involves ontological horror. Ontological horror is one of the key terms for this course, and it's important for us to understand what it actually entails. Ontological horror is the feeling that's inspired when categories, or the categories that we use to understand the world, begin to break down. Human beings, both Lovecraft and Joshi say, have this natural inclination to find patterns, to see patterns inside the universe. And in those, or through those patterns, or through the application of those patterns, we begin to develop comfortable categories within the universe, breaking it down into comprehensible and easily neutralized components, or smaller portions or pieces. It's easy for us to say, well, this thing is an animal and this thing is human. It's perhaps not actually easy, but it's comfortable. It makes us feel better when we can break down the world into smaller bite-sized bits through the process of categorization. That's what ontology means. Ontology is fundamentally the philosophy of categorization, how we organize things based on their natures, their beings, and then categorize them in turn. Now, it's a good deal more complicated than that, but as a general overview of ontology, that's what ontology basically means. It's the philosophy of categorization. Ontological horror is the feeling that we have when suddenly all the categories that we use to understand the world start to break down. Things start to fragment. They no longer make sense. So, as an example, we have a visceral, physical, unpleasant reaction to the violation of these categories when we see a zombie. A zombie is terrifying to us, Yashi and Lovecraft would say, based on this concept of ontological horror, not just because it's this rotting, putrescent corpse that can kill us and cause us to die and turn into this hideous creature much like itself. No, it's disturbing to us on a more fundamental level because it violates our systems of categorization. A zombie is neither alive nor dead, and yet it's both. Just like a vampire. A vampire is quite literally the living dead. A werewolf is an animal, but it's also human in a strange way. So most of these classical monsters, like ghosts and goblins, and thus most of the classical horror stories that are oriented around them, violate our systems of ontology, our systems of categorizing and classifying things in the world, of organizing it. The feeling that results from these violations is ontological horror. The second kind of weird tale that Yashi identifies is non-supernatural horror. Non-supernatural horror is a very broad category. All tales of horror, in a sense, that are not explicitly science fiction, we'll talk about this as a subcategory in another moment, or supernatural, fall into this category. If you want to think about a tale that could be weird, or that could at least be horror and not a weird tale, you might think about Robert Bloch's Psycho or Bates Motel, wherein you have an axe murderer. In these kinds of stories, nothing supernatural actually occurs, but for a time, it appears that there might be something supernatural going on. There seems like there's a suspension of natural law, but in the end, it's just coincidence, it's just fate, it's just a series of happenstances that make something supernatural appear to happen, but they don't. Now, this is a kind of ridiculous example, but if any of you are familiar with Scooby-Doo, and at the end of Scooby-Doo, they unmask the apparent ghost, well, that's kind of like a non-supernatural horror tale. Right? You feel the feelings of horror. You think that there's something impossible, something magical, a ghost or a demon or the like coming out at you. But by the end of the story, you tear off the mask, and suddenly you see, well, it was just old man Jenkerson who was trying to scare people off his farm. This is the nature of some kinds of non-supernatural tales. The feeling of the weird is provoked because you think that you're encountering something supernatural, but in the end, those feelings are neutralized by the revelation that nothing supernatural really took place at all. Other kinds of non-supernatural horror will reveal that what we believe to be unnatural or supernatural was in fact just a delusion on the part of an unreliable narrator. Or a series of mistakes. Well, I heard this noise in the night, and I was sure that it was something out there menacing me in the darkness, something that was beyond my understanding. But then, you know, I woke up in the morning and I saw that it was just, I don't know, a tree branch rapping against my window. So I had all the feelings, or the character inside the story had all those feelings of the weird tale. The reader experienced them vicariously through the character, but in the end, the story revealed there was nothing supernatural going on at all. This category is a little bit complex because it can be broken down into several other sort of even smaller subgenres. One of these subsets of non-supernatural weird tales or non-supernatural horror fiction is psychological horror. That itself can be broken down into two types. The first is the conte cruel, which we already discussed briefly in relation to Lovecraft. This is a kind of story that deals with the cruelties of fate. It seems like the world or the universe is out to get you. It seems like there's this strange confluence of happenstance and circumstances that makes you believe that there's some greater power or greater force that's out to get you, something supernatural. There are just too many odd, unnatural, and unpleasant things happening to you at the same time to be explained by mere happenstance. But that is the explanation. In the end, it's just chance. You just had a real horrible spate of bad luck, and all these things that looked like they were part of a much larger, grandiose, supernatural plan affecting you and destroying you are revealed to be, well, just chance. The horror here largely pertains to torture, depravity of human beings, and mental anguish, in that the character is suffering horribly, but in the end it's revealed that, well, it's only us and fate. There's nothing supernatural going on. One of the most horrifying things I've ever read came from Golding's The Lord of the Flies. In The Lord of the Flies, you have a group of school children in this novel. This group of school children who are marooned on an island, and they start out with the best of intentions and these wondrous aspirations of establishing a new civilization, carrying forward the ideals of democracy and liberty that they brought with them from their civilized societies. The characters actually become convinced that there's something supernatural on this island. A fighter pilot ejects from his plane as he's dying, and his parachute gets caught in the trees atop this mountain on the island. The children don't know that this fighter pilot was shot down, and when they go to the top of the mountain in the dark, they see just this strange figure that's almost billowing up and falling down. It's really just the pilot whose parachute has become tangled up in the trees. And every time the wind blows in this particular way, the parachute inflates and the corpse jerks up. And the children think that this is a monster or a demon, the Lord of the Flies that governs the island. The children descend into savagery and horror, depravity. They begin murdering each other, all based on this new, or partially based on this new religion that evolves around the fantastical beast, the Lord of the Flies, on top of the island. Only one child seems capable of identifying what's really going on. He goes to the top of the mountain, sees what's happening, and Simon, this child, recognizes what's really going on. But he can never really communicate this information to the people down below. Simon is responsible for delivering one of the most horrifying lines in that entire story. He looks at the other heroes of the tale, and as they're wondering about the strange supernatural forces that might be at work on the island, he says, "I don't know, maybe it's only us." That is one of the most horrifying lines I've ever encountered in literature. Because what it tells us is that everything that they see around them, all the depravity that is displayed between these children who are murdering each other, who have descended from civilization to savagery at the drop of a hat when they were just taken out of their comfortable, familiar environment, all of that, everything that they've seen, everything that they've done, maybe it's only us. Maybe there are no gods or demons that are influencing our behavior. Maybe there's no little devil on my shoulder that's warping my mind and twisting me to the most perverse actions and inspiring everything that we see around us. Maybe all that there is, everything will ever amount to, everything that life and all the purposelessness of life will ever be, maybe it's only us. And maybe all the depravity that we inflict upon each other, well, it's only us. That is the Conqueruel. There is no God. There is no devil. There is no supernatural. Everything that we inflict, all the horrors that we see therein, well, it's only us. The other kind of non-supernatural psychological horror story is the pseudo-supernatural. These stories present us with explicit moments that seem to be violations of natural law. Something impossible seems to happen. However, the pseudo-supernatural eventually gives way, not necessarily because there's an explanation provided in physical terms. Oh, I thought that I saw a ghost, or I thought that I saw something levitating, but really it was just a series of mirrors and strings. It was an illusionist trick, so there was no violation of natural laws. That is not the only thing that happens in these pseudo-supernatural tales. In a pseudo-supernatural tale, those things that seem supernatural can often be neutralized by the recognition that the narrator of the story is insane. He's just delusional. He's hallucinating something that isn't real, or he's misunderstanding or misinterpreting what's actually going on. Like those children atop the mountain, seeing the parachute billow up and the corpse rise like some kind of fantastical monstrous beast, when in reality, they were just had a failure of perception. The next kind of subcategory for the weird tale, according to Yashi, is fantasy. In a fantasy story, the natural laws of the universe that we encounter are fundamentally different from those of our own. Natural laws can't be assumed. So for instance, take a fantasy story like Lord of the Rings or Harry Potter. When you enter into that world, you're immediately confronted with the reality that everything that you encounter in that story, however terrifying or frightening it might be, isn't unnatural. It can't inspire the feelings of terror surrounding the unknown that is associated with a weird tale because, well, there's no such thing as ontological breakdown. Take the Lord of the Rings and a marvelous scene from Lord of the Rings when that you can see in the description to this video, wherein the Ringwraiths, the great kings of men who have been turned into half-men, half-spirit beings that serve the will of Sauron, the deceiver, they go into the city of Bree and try to kill the hobbits, the heroes of this story. When the characters see them and how they react to them signal to us that the characters are afraid. However, they can't inspire the feelings of the weird. Because in the logic of this fantasy universe, well, you have rings of power and ghosts and goblins and monsters. You have wizards. These things are not supernatural. They're natural. They're part of the universe. They don't violate natural laws according to the story. The characters treat them as something terrifying, but for them, they can kill you. But they're no different than some kind of orc or goblin or bear in our own universe because, well, they're a natural part of it. The natural laws of this universe are such that these kinds of things, like a ringwraith or a goblin, can exist. These stories present to us fundamentally alien worlds that operate on their own laws, on their own terms. You can't have realism in this kind of story because you're presented with a world with, well, dragons and goblins and ghosts that are a natural part of it. What seems to be a violation, or what would seem to be a violation of natural laws in our world, can't be assumed as such. So for instance, there's a moment in The Hobbit, or The Hobbit movies, if you're familiar with those, where two mountains begin to fight each other. These giant stone golems that they believe to be mountains come alive and begin crashing into each other in this titanic struggle. Now the characters are terrified and they flee because, well, the mountains, which is a rather strange way of putting it, the mountains can kill them. But they flee as we would from a bear. This is not impossible for them, according to the laws of their universe. What can be done in these stories is that laws can be established, laws that are different from ours, but they can then be violated. So if the characters indicated to us in this fantasy story that, well, magic doesn't exist and it's a really low fantasy settings, think about Game of Thrones. In Game of Thrones, the Red Woman and the mysticism surrounding her deity, these things are horrifying to many of the characters, and they treat it as something abnormal because none of them have ever seen magic like this before. It's a low magic setting, and so when something magical does happen, they treat it in the same way that we would in our own universe. That's a case of establishing laws of normalcy and then introducing elements that violate them, even in a fantasy setting. Lastly, you have quasi-science fiction. In the quasi-science fiction weird tale, the norms of our universe exist. The same kind of approaches are adopted as in the supernatural weird tale, wherein you have a basis of realism, and then the realism sets a juxtaposition against the fantastic element that makes it stand out all the more. You have realism, everything is going along, everything works according to the way I would expect for a normal story, and then suddenly something is introduced, something in the supernatural tale, like a ghost or a demon, or the suggestions of something like that, that begin to upset my understanding of the natural laws of this world or to violate them. So the quasi-science fiction tale, weird tale, works in the same way. It has a realistic approach. But the difference is that the natural laws that exist in this world and the natural laws that we understand from our own world are not explicitly violated. Rather, they're amended or supplemented. So new natural laws are introduced into this world that are alien to ours, but we realize that the natural laws that existed in this world, or that we thought existed in this world, and that we think exist in ours, were really just pale shadows of a much grander reality that we couldn't understand. Think about it like this. For someone living 2,000 years ago, that person would have been absolutely convinced that outside of magic, per se, flight was impossible. It was something supernatural. So if he saw a plane flying overhead, he would think that was magic. But in reality, we have a greater understanding of natural law today. We know that that plane is flying purely because we've leveraged the power of physics and chemistry in order to do something that seems impossible to him. There's another clip in the description of this video involving Star Trek, wherein Captain Catherine Janeway is talking to a holographic computer simulation of Leonardo da Vinci. What I'd like you to do is pause the video, take a look at that clip, and then come back and I'll discuss it briefly. Okay, so in that clip, you saw Leonardo da Vinci wondering at the things he's seen in this world. He's seen energy weapons and people disappearing using matter-energy transportation devices. So they're in one place and then suddenly they're in a completely different place. And he asks Captain Janeway, this woman who's traveling with him, to explain this. Captain Janeway says that she can't because there are some things that your mind is simply too small to understand. That is kind of the basis of the quasi-science fiction tale. We are Leonardo da Vinci in the sense that there are things in this world that we simply can't understand. There are natural laws beyond any that we could ever comprehend or any that we could ever actually hope to grapple with. And it's those natural laws that actually enter into operation. We see them. And just like Leonardo da Vinci thinks, this is magic. Am I dead? I felt this laser beam go right through me. A lightning bolt passed through my body. Am I a spirit? Immediately, he turns to the supernatural to try to explain it, because his program as this artificial intelligence, the limitations of his mind, can't allow him to process what's actually going on, can't allow him to understand it. That is the nature of the quasi-science fiction weird tale, and we are Leonardo da Vinci, or the program of Leonardo da Vinci. We see something that seems impossible, that seems supernatural, but in the quasi-science fiction weird tale, we are given to understand that this is in fact merely the representation of natural laws that transcend any that we could understand. The supernatural is merely an illusion. Just like this ancient man seeing a plane thinking it's magic, we encounter things like aliens or the like that seem to violate the natural laws of the universe as we understand them, and do. But it's not something impossible. It's not something magical. It's not something supernatural. It's just a kind of science that we cannot understand, and in fact can never understand. The feeling associated with this kind of story is not ontological horror, but epistemological horror. Epistemology means the philosophy of knowledge. So if I was to ask you a question like, well, how do you know what you know? What's the basis of knowledge? Or can you ever really know anything with 100% certitude? Those would be epistemological questions. In the sense that this story presents us with the reality that there are things that we don't understand in this universe, and because of the inherent limitations of us as human beings, we can never understand, it inspires epistemological horror, this terror that we do not understand the universe. We thought we did. We thought we had a handle on things. We thought things were comfortable for us. But then it was all ripped away from us, and in reality, we never understood anything at all. So these are the four major classifications of weird tales that Yashi provides to us. And like I said, we're going to go through all four of them with reference to stories. So we'll have a supernatural weird tale in the form of the Mark of the Beast, perhaps arguably a non-supernatural weird tale in the Orla, a work of fantasy in Through the Dragonglass, and finally a quasi-science fiction weird tale in The Call of Cthulhu by H.P. Lovecraft. And we'll also look at a film representation of that same genre in The Thing.